I've had Parkinson's since I was 28 years old, and I'm 41 now.
Mr. O'Grady is a young onset Parkinson patient who developed tremor predominant symptoms.
My principal symptoms at first were just a slight tremor in my right hand and arm, which got worse, and then it switched over to my left arm and hand, and then eventually went to my facial tremors, for my jaw would tremor, and my lips would also have a tremor in them as well.
He got to a point with the tremors being so bad that if we went to a restaurant, he couldn't cut his own steak.
His main problem has been tremor all along. For some patients, tremor is the main problem, and it can interfere with use of the hands because of the shaking. In his case, I believe he had trouble at work because of the tremor.
He had been an aircraft mechanic in the military and was always very proud of what he did and his ability to do that type of work. So the work he does now, it did start to hamper what he could do because he's a mechanic.
He got to the point where it was impacting my job. I wasn't able to hold a nut, put on a bolt.
Medications really by definition help all patients with Parkinson's disease in the early stages of the disease.
At first the medications controlled my tremors pretty well, and then I had to take more and more medication to control them to where it got to a point where the medications were no longer helping.
The most common thing we see is that a dose of medication doesn't last as long as it used to, so now the doses need to be taken more and more frequently. And then we find that we need to elevate the doses of medication to achieve the same level of symptom control. And when we do that, we sometimes run into side effects.
Side effects were dry mouth, lethargic with the medications that I was on and the amount that I was taking at the time. And there were other symptoms. Some days I'd be really tired. Some days I just didn't really want to function or even go to work. And at that point, the doctors decided that it was time for my quality of life and satisfaction, I guess, of being happier. It was time to have the DBS procedure done.
Deep brain stimulation is a surgical treatment for patients with Parkinson's disease that has advanced to the point where their medicines are no longer effective.
The DBS system has three components. There is an electrode that's implanted by the surgeon into the brain, connected to a wire that then is connected to a pacemaker type device placed in the chest. This is a fully implantable system, and the device delivers electrical pulses to these deep brain targets that are malfunctioning in Parkinson's disease.
The heart of the system is this electrode. This is the electrode that goes into the brain. And it's quite small and it's flexible. It's about the size of a number two pencil lead. It's 1.2 millimeters in diameter. And the goal is to place this into a specific area of the brain. I have a cross-section model of a brain here, and these structures are actually down in the very bottom, the very base of the brain. That's why we call it deep brain stimulation. And so one of the areas is this purple area, for example, that's the thalamus. And so we'll come through this part, this frontal part of the brain called the frontal lobe, to implant the electrode in this area. So the incision goes across the top of the head, usually just behind the hairline, and we'll put a small hole in the skull, and this wire will go into the brain, and then the wire runs underneath the skin, sort of behind the ear, down along the neck, and it comes just below the collarbone to another incision where we place the battery pack, or we call it the pulse generator. And this is what that looks like.
We don't know exactly why it's helpful, but we think that the electrical pulses block or override the abnormal brain activity that's occurring at those targets. When those circuits then have more normal activity, they can control movements better. So the tremor is improved, the stiffness is improved, the slowness is improved, the walking is improved.
So there are risks with doing DBS surgery. It is a brain operation, and we're putting these electrodes deep down into the brain.
And the most serious potential complication is bleeding in the brain, hemorrhage, which can cause a stroke.
So the risk of causing any amount of bleeding in the brain is about 2 to 3%. So 2 or 3 people out of 100 can have bleeding in the brain with DBS surgery. Now, fortunately, most of the time, it's a very small amount of blood, and it actually doesn't cause symptoms. But the risk of having a hemorrhage large enough to cause symptoms is 0.5%. So it's 1 in 200. But if you get a big hemorrhage, it can be devastating. It could paralyze a patient, it could put a patient in a coma, and it could kill them. So people can and have died having this surgery done. So that's an important thing to think about.
I had no complications with my surgery. Surgery went fine. Recovery was no problem. I was in and out of the hospital in a couple of days and back at home. No infections, no bleeding.
Well, the outcome that Mr. O'Grady achieved was pretty typical in that the tremor is substantially reduced, and we've been able to accomplish that with lower doses of medication as well. And in his case, the medicines had been causing some side effects for him, and by being able to reduce the medicines, we were able to reduce those and eliminate, frankly, those side effects. So now he has much better function, the ability to use the hands, the tremor really doesn't bother him at all, and he's able to take less medication.
From the second it was over and they came out and said, you know, it was a success, you know, it's amazing, you won't believe the results.
As soon as they turned it on here in the office with Susan programming me, it was amazing.
Deep brain stimulation programming, in the beginning, there's several sessions depending on the symptoms and when you start. But after you get it tuned up to where the patient's doing well, usually once a year for an adjustment.
She does several tests where she checks my hand movements, my speech, my leg controls, different functions, and then she'll make a small adjustment up or down on the sensitivity.
The patient controller, the programmer, has a display on it. They can see what their settings are.
I can also control the stimulation up and down within a set parameter.
One of the features that we take advantage of is to pre-program into the device different scenarios, and the patient can try them all out.
We can give them plan A or group A and group B. Try this for a week and see how you like it, and try this for a week and see how you like it.
Work is really important to me. I fear the longer that I can work, the longer it'll take my progression to progress because I'm staying active.
I think that the spouses notice that with the DBS surgery, a type of bradykinesia is loss of facial expression and their smile returns.
We were in the room and Susan was programming him, and she had him walk, and he could swing his arms again, which I hadn't seen him do in a long, long time. And that's when I had to leave the room because that was kind of a tearjerker for me. And he could smile again. He had his big smile back, and I think that was the moment that, you know, I was most grateful for.
I believed in it, that it was going to help. It was a big step for myself to take. But I'm glad I did it. And the after effects of it have been a real big positive for me in my life. To know that I can keep being productive, spend time with my wife, my kids.